Park in Boston. The Seattle Mariners take on the Boston Red Sox. And the matchup today, lefty Mark Langston for the Mariners and Tom Seaver for Boston. Seaver, at the age of 41, picked up by the Red Sox and won his Boston debut, defeating Toronto last Tuesday. The Sox offensively still led by Wade Boggs, seeking his third batting championship, comes in today hitting .376. It's overcast and unseasonably cool. Temperature in the 70s at Fenway Park in Boston today. Another big crowd will look on. The venerable structure, which right now houses the team on top in the American League East, the Red Sox, as we approach the halfway mark of the 1986 season, 7 in front of the Yankees in the Eastern Division. I'm Al Michaels, and this is the final game of a 3-game series between the Red Sox and Seattle. And one reason for Boston's success this season has been pitching. You all know about Roger Clemens, who will be in action tomorrow night on Monday Night Baseball against Oakland. And Oil Can Boyd has pitched very well, and they've been able to withstand injuries to Al Nipper and Bruce Hurst. But they went out and proved to their fans, if no one else, how serious they were about winning this whole thing this year. When they picked up Tom Seaver from the White Sox last week, he made his Boston debut last Tuesday, gave up 4 runs in 7 innings, good enough to beat Toronto, and he's on the mound again today. Let me turn now to Jim Palmer, and let's talk about the acquisition of Seaver. And do you think it will make a bigger difference for Boston on the field or off the field the rest of the way?
Well, I really think Tom will have a great impact both on and off the field. And of course, he's a lot like Donnie Baylor, who has come over from the Yankees this year, and he's had an impact both on and off the field, influence in the clubhouse, but he has also let his bat do the talking. Tom is the same way. He's, I think, again, being a guy that's pitched for years and years and years, is a realist. And what he said is, I'm going to go out there, I'm going to try to pitch 7 innings, I'm going to try to give up 3 runs or less. He wasn't able to do that against Toronto, but the one important thing he did do is keep his ball club in the game. They eventually won 9-7. That's what he wants to do every time out. I really think, though, that Tom had a lot of distractions in Chicago. He won his 300th game last year, probably lost a little bit of intensity. He kind of had the circus-like atmosphere over there, a team that won 85 games last year, and this year they made all these changes. So he's coming over here. He's closer to his family. Had the untimely death of his mother, who he's very close to early in the year. I think he's a man with a mission. He wants to not only help them win a pennant, but I think he wants to contribute, and he knows he has to do that by pitching well.
It's worth noting at this point that the supposed experts before the season, I think the consensus had the Red Sox finishing fourth or fifth. A few picked them as low as sixth. They're to be taken seriously right now, but how seriously in your estimation? Do you think this team's going to go all the way?
I think they have a very good chance, the best in many years, and the reason for that is their pitching. And of course, picking up a guy like Tom Seaver will help not only the younger pitchers, but the older pitchers. But the bottom line is, I honestly think they can get better. They have a lot of hitters in their lineup that struggled early, are seeming to get hot. Jim Rice, only 8 home runs, so he can get better, too. So I think they're a better team as the summer progresses.
So it's Seaver and the Red Sox against Seattle.
ABC Sunday Afternoon Baseball is brought to you by Chevrolet, who invites you to drive today's Chevy, live today's Chevy. By exceptionally smooth Michelob, it could make tonight the best part of your day. And by Honda Power Equipment, lawn mowers, lawn tractors, and portable generators made to last.
Take a look right now at the Mariner lineup facing Tom Seaver. They begin with John Moses, the switch-hitting center fielder. Then Phil Bradley is in left field. And Jim Presley, who's hit 17 homers, bats third. The cleanup hitter is Ken Phelps, the first baseman. Batting fifth is Danny Tartable, and he's hit 13 home runs. Scott Bradley does the catching, bats sixth. Dave Henderson is the designated hitter in the seventh spot. Their shortstop, batting eighth, is Spike Owen. And hitting ninth is Harold Reynolds, with Mark Langston working on the mound. And defensively for the Red Sox, the outfield, Jim Rice in left, Tony Armas in center, and Dwight Evans around in right. And Boggs at third. Ray Quinones is the shortstop. Marty Barrett at second. And Bill Buckner gets the day off. And Dave Stapleton gets a very rare start at first. Mark Sullivan is catching as Rich Gedman gets the day off, at least at the outset. And there is Seaver. And That is his combined record. He was 2-6 with the White Sox, 1-0 with the Red Sox, giving up less than a hit per inning with 29 walks and 33 strikeouts. And that in itself tells you that Tom is a pitcher in transition, as Moses hits the first pitch of the game in the air to left field and right to Jim Rice. One out here in the first inning, and that'll bring Phil Bradley to the plate. In facing the Mariners, the Red Sox are facing a team that's been pretty hot of late. They have won 5 of 6. Earlier in the week, they swept a 3-game series from Kansas City. And it's a team that is only a game under 500 since Dick Williams took over for Chuck Cotter on the 9th of May. So even though the Mariners, and there is Williams, who managed here and managed the Red Sox to a pennant 19 years ago.
He's made a number of changes, gave everybody a rule book. And a lot of it's amazing how many young players don't know the rules, but very aggressive young ball club. A lot of people picked them to win in the American League West. Very disappointing start for them, but they've, as you said, been playing a lot better.
Swing and a miss, and the count is 0-2. And even though Seattle is 10 games out, you don't figure that anybody's going to run away with the American League West. So Williams, at least, feels they still have a shot at the top. Vic Voltaggio is back of the plate today. Tim Welke is the umpire at first. Mark Johnson at second. And the veteran Larry McCoy at third. 2-2 the count on Bradley. Former All-Big 8 quarterback at the University of Missouri, who hit no home runs as a rookie and then 26 in his next season. And takes that for call, strike three. So he got fooled, and Seaver strikes Bradley out, who puts up a mild beef, and that's out number two.
Well, the one thing that Tom Seaver hasn't lost, and you talked about the transition, is a good control of his fastball. Still has excellent velocity, can spot the ball, and the big difference I've seen this year and last year, where he won 15 games, is where he's gotten the ball in the strike zone as far as height. A lot of pitches have been up. And again, being in Chicago, a lot of things that distract you, you can kind of have a kind of tunnel vision, I suppose, up here in Boston, because joining a team that I think had a 9-game lead when he came over, he realizes he has to pitch well.
Jim Presley is the batter and takes outside. A look around fabled Fenway, 315 down into the left field corner, then 379 to left center, 420 to the deepest part of the park, 380 to the gap in right center, and a very short 302 right down the line and right, where Presley hits it, but curling foul, and the count is 1-1.
Very easy ballpark to hit home runs in left field, but when you start talking about center, right field, very difficult. Really have to get into one. You talk to all the left-handed hitters, and unless you can go the other way, of course Wade Boggs can, it's tough to hit home runs here.
2-1 on the Mariner third baseman. Presley hit 2 home runs opening night, and the second was a grand slammer in the 10th inning to beat California, and then he went a month without hitting another. But he has 17. He's also struck out 84 times and takes a good sweeping curve for a strike. And the count 2-2.
And there's another difference in Tom Seaver. If you talk about the Tom Seaver 10 years ago, it did not have that curveball. As he's gotten older, he's come up with a changeup. He turns his fastball over. And he's also worked on a curveball to go along with the slider and the high rider, the four-seamer that he throws up in the strike zone.
You'd think Clemens was pitching the way the crowd is responding, and the 2-2 pitch is fouled away. Here in Boston, as is the case in so many ballparks, with 2 strikes and a strikeout pitcher working, the rhythmic clapping begins in anticipation of a strikeout, something that Clemens is noted for, something that Seaver has been noted for in the past, of course, but here it is again with a count, 2 balls and 2 strikes.
It's also something that Jim Presley is noted for.
That's right.
Started out the season with 54 strikeouts in 42 games.
3-2.
You talk to Dick Williams, who manages the Seattle Mariners, that as we take a nice look at Tom. He's remarkably young for a man of his age.
Don't look, 41. And there the 57-year-old Dick Williams as the 3-2 pitch is fished and foul.
But anyway, Dick Williams in talking about, he said we were going to set an all-time record for strikeouts. And I think when you have a young ball club, you can't tell them to stop being aggressive. But what you can say is with two strikes, let's stop swinging for the fences. Let's have a little bit more bat control. And since they've done that, not only are the averages come up, but so the strikeouts have decreased.
3-2 to Presley is fouled away again. Seattle batters have struck out 609 times, or about 7.5 times per game through the course of the season. Jim just talking about what Williams has tried to incorporate, however, a different attitude. And part of the reason he's been able to do that is he's lopped off a couple of guys by the name of Gorman Thomas and Al Cowens from the roster and replaced them with those who don't strike out as often as Presley goes down swinging. So Seaver comes through for the crowd. They anticipated the strikeout and they got it. Today's lineup for the Boston Red Sox. Marty Barrett's been hot. He leads things off at second base. And then the league's leading hitter, Wade Boggs, bats second. Bill Buckner has the day off, so Dave Stapleton starts at first. And Jim Rice is the cleanup hitter. Then the designated hitter in his first year with Boston, Don Baylor. Batting sixth is the durable one, Dwight Evans. Tony Armas is the center fielder on an everyday basis now. Mark Sullivan does the catching. Rich Gedman is on the bench today. And Ray Quiñones is the shortstop hitting ninth. And defensively for Seattle, they go with Ken Phelps at first base. Alvin Davis is on the disabled list. Harold Reynolds is the second baseman. And the shortstop is Spike Owen with Jim Presley around at third. And the outfield back of Mark Langston has Phil Bradley in left field. John Moses, who started the season in the minor leagues, the 29-year-old center fielder. And Danny Tartable in right. Good power. Back of the plate today is Scott Bradley. Steve Yeager is the other Mariner catcher, and he just came off the disabled list. And Mark Langston is on the mound. And Langston has been hot. He has won his last five starts.
Well, a great rookie year, winning 17 games. Last year was 7-14. Had elbow problems throughout the year. This year, as you said, five-game winning streak. If you talk to anybody on the Mariners team, they tell you what an outstanding stuff he has, and he has four pitches. Overpowering fastball, good slider, curveball, and changeup. And when he gets them over, even though he primarily pitches with only his slider and his fastball, he can be really tough. Beat the Red Sox here early in the year on a one hitter for 7 innings, 7-1. Only run was the home run by Mark Sullivan.
If you missed it, Boris Becker was dominant today as he beats Yvon Lendl in straight sets in a little bit more than 2 hours to win a second consecutive Wimbledon championship.
Had a chance to watch that, and it's amazing how much playing at Wimbledon is like pitching in a close ball game. You make one or two mistakes and you lose the match or you lose the game. Today, very evenly played match, except who made the most mistakes? Lendl. Of course, we're sitting here in a ballpark that usually is not settled by one or two mistakes. A couple of three-run home runs and big innings, and this is a ballpark where you never are out of the ball game, and I think the fans understand that.
9-7 is not an uncommon score here. John McNamara managing his 15th. He had Seaver when he managed at Cincinnati in the late 70s. And Barrett increases his hitting streak to 13. So Marty Barrett, who comes in hitting 295, approaching the 300 mark with a single to left, and Boggs coming up.
Well, Presley playing in to respect Barrett's ability to bunt, just can't get to the ground ball. Interesting, the Seattle right fielder and center field, Moses, are shifted all the way to right field, but the left fielder playing down the line. Kind of an unusual defensive alignment, but it saved a double there.
Now Wade Boggs. Barrett leads the team in steals with 7. The Red Sox do very little running. They have stolen a total of 18 bases. We're about 3 weeks worth for a Vince Coleman. 18 bases in almost a half season. This is game number 80, so tomorrow is the halfway mark. And Barrett is tops with seven, and there he goes. His box takes high, and there's no throw. Number eight for Marty Barrett, who got a good jump on Langston.
Well, what you do off left-hander is go on his first move. If he doesn't come to first, and he takes a long time to deliver the ball, which Langston does, you're going to beat a throw. I think this base can be attributed to surprise. Again, as you see on the graphic, Barrett runs more than any other Red Sox.
Here's the 1-1 now. Boggs bluffs a bunt and takes outside. They appeal at third and don't get the call there, and the count, two balls and one strike. So Barrett with a 13-game hitting streak, off to his lead at second. 2-1 on the league's leading hitter, Wade Boggs, who has already won two batting titles in his 4 years in the league.
Incidentally, 0-10 lifetime against Langston, but with six walks, so his on-base percentage is way over, what, 333, showing that even if he doesn't get hits, he can help a ball club by getting on base because of his excellent ability to take a walk.
That's grounded to the right side, and it moves Barrett to third as Reynolds takes care of Boggs for out number one.
We saw a prime example of unselfishness. Boggs does not hit the ball that well to the right side of the field. They usually put a shift on him. Hits the ball almost exclusively to the left of second base, yet took the breaking ball, hit it to second base, and advanced the runner to third. Of course, I suppose when you're hitting up in the 370s, you can give yourself up for the good of the team every once in a while.
And he moves Barrett to third with one out. Here's an interesting case now. This is where Bill Buckner would normally bat, but you've got Stapleton at the plate, and the pitch is a strike. So Buckner gets a day off. It's a good day to give your first baseman, a left-handed batter, off, in as much as Langston is on the mound. The odd thing here, though, is that McNamara has opted to put a man who's been to the plate nine times this season in the three spot, and he tries to bunt and fouls it back. That was not the squeeze, as Barrett was staying at third.
Well, it sets up a situation that I had. I pitched this Saturday afternoon ball game, nothing and nothing, against John Tudor back, I guess, in the early 80s, and lost on a sacrifice fly by this gentleman right here. So he knows to look for a pitch that he can hit to the outfield. Fly ball will score a run with the infield back. The ball to shortstop or second base will score a run. And the unfortunate thing for Dave Stapleton is he hasn't been at the plate very often.
Stapleton 3-for-9 this season, as Buckner has been in there just about every day. And a breaking pitch is swung on and missed. The runner holding at third, Barrett, and a throw to first base is there as Phelps is able to come down on the bag. And here comes the argument with McNamara going at it with Tim Welke. And Stapleton contending he was on the bag and the first baseman was off the bag. And Welke is now going to get some help from the plate umpire, Voltaggio. And he wins the argument, and now it's Dick Williams' turn. Wants to know how Voltaggio at home plate can call it any better than Welke at first base.
And Welke's saying, he asked me to get help, I did, and that's what the other umpires are out there for. Of course, Dick Williams is questioning. Rather animated conversation.
Pick up part of it from one of our crab mice as well.
Again, Dick Williams, having been around for years and years and years, he knows Seaver's on the mound. He's throwing well. It's nice to have that second out instead of having runners at first and third.
It's a strikeout, and then an error is charged to the catcher, Scott Bradley, who had to think about not only throwing to first base, but he had to look Barrett back to third.
Well, he took his time, Al. He did exactly what you should do. to. He checked the runner at third, then made the throw to first, but the throw was high. Very difficult play for a first base umpire. Not only does he have to watch whether Phelps tagged the runner, he has to see if he comes down on the bag. A lot of things to watch, so invariably you might not get the call right. You see the curveball in the dirt. Checks the runner, makes the throw, and here the problem arises. Now Welke is looking at Phelps. He's seeing if he tagged the bag, which he did. Seeing whether he tagged him before he got to the bag. John McNamara, managing the Red Sox, says, hey, get some help. And he did. They changed the call. Which does not make Dick Williams very happy. Brings Jim Wright to Bryce to the place, hitting 335 this year. I suppose if you had to bring anybody up in the American League to hit into a double play, at least in years past, you would want it to be Jim Rice.
And the infield of double play depth, as Bradley has a little trouble with that one as well. So Langston tries to induce a ground ball with runners at first and third. One out, bottom of the first inning. Rice at 335, so he's up among the league leaders, but his power production way down, only 8 home runs up high.
Well, last year, Al, he hit into 35 double plays. And the reason for this, of course, is that the Red Sox don't bunt, they don't steal, they don't advance runners very often. So you're going to have more opportunities. I think Jim is really trying to go the other way, hit a lot of balls to right field.
He hits that one down the line and right, but curling foul and back out of play.
Took a lot of criticism last year. Had an excellent year. Drove in over 100 runs, hit 28 home runs. Hit 291, yet he was criticized because of the double plays. Unfairly so.
He's led or tied for the American League lead in grounding into double plays in each of the last 4 seasons. He hits that one to just about the same spot.
He went around and asked most baseball fans, do you think Cal Ripken, one of the outstanding offensive and defensive players in the American League, hits a lot of double plays? Say, well, not that many. He hit in 32 last year. Nobody's bad-mouthing him. So I think Jim has made a conscious effort to hit the ball to right field, which he can do because of his strength.
Inside. 3 balls and 2 strikes. Barrett is at third. And Stapleton at first. Let's see if they send him. They do, and it's hit to right center for a base hit. Barrett comes in to score. Stapleton goes to third, and Boston leads 1-0.
If you had a team meeting before the game and you said, where should we pitch Jim Rice, you'd say up and in. Look where this pitch is. 3-2, good pitch. Again, we talked about the strength that Jim Rice possesses. Just fights in it over the infield for a base hit. Most guys either break a bat or you get a soft fly ball. The run doesn't score.
Now Williams comes out again and he wants the first base umpire, Welke. As he walks right by Mark Johnson. Now Williams must have something else on it. I would think he's got something else in addition to what the original argument was about. Over the last call, there was something that provoked his second visit.
Question, is he going to say anything to Mark Langston on the way back? Because if he does, it's a visit, and he's not.
So Don Baylor waits for Williams to go back to the dugout with Boston on top 1-0 here in the bottom of the first inning. And Baylor, who's gone a little bit more than 3 weeks without a home run. And that's something that hasn't happened in 6 years. Infield still at double play depth. And it's inside, ball one.
It's also in this ballpark something that can change in a hurry. Donnie last year apparently couldn't hit right-handers. Still hit 24 home runs at Yankee Stadium, one of the most difficult parks to hit home runs in.
1-1.
What makes Mark Langston effective is that he does have the 4 pitches we talked about, the changeup, the curveball, the slider, and the fastball, but he comes in, he goes away. He's in and out. He is not a comfortable guy to hit off. Throws the ball a lot like Sid Fernandez, who's already won 10 games for the Mets on different planes. He'll throw a high riding fastball, and then he'll spot the ball low and away. So it'd be very effective.
We didn't see it, but the message board just says Dick Williams has been ejected from the game. And so it was a case of Williams getting the thumb, and obviously that's what precipitated that last visit. 3-2, but it went pretty much unnoticed. There was no overt gesture from any of the umpires, but Williams has apparently been thrown out of the game with Stapleton at third and Rice at first and one out.
What Mark Langston has to try away from, try to stay away from, is the big inning, especially in this ballpark. Give them up one at a time here.
That's grounded to Presley at third. He goes to Reynolds for one, and he turns it over for a double play. Reynolds really hanging in at second. And at the end of one, it's 1-0 Boston. Tom Seaver making his second start since coming over from the White Sox, and John McNamara talks about the acquisition.
Well, we started that quest last December in San Diego at the winter meetings, and we felt that he would just give us the experience, the knowledge, the know-how, an example of what pitching is all about, hard work. He won 16 ball games last year, and we felt that he would be he would anchor our pitching staff.
Well, I'm not quite sure he'll anchor it necessarily, but he'll be a pretty vital cog if he can be anything like the Seaver of old down the stretch.
Of course, the realist that he is, he also quickly pointed out that he thought he could help them. They were already 9 games in front without him, and he'd have to pitch like he did in the past to help them.
And it's a changeup that he starts Phelps with for a strike, 0-1.
Again, that little changeup curveball that he's come up with over the last 3 or 4 years. Most older pitchers, to make that transition, have to come up with another pitch.
That one looked like it got away.
Well, did. It's not an easy pitch to throw, especially when you have been a pitcher, as we said earlier, a fastball slider pitcher, which takes a lot of arm speed. What you have to do is try to give the hitter the illusion you have the same arm speed, but the ball has to get up there a lot slower.
2-1 to count on Phelps. Phelps, 13 homers in 133 at-bats, and through his career, he's averaged one every 13.2 at-bats and rips that one into right field for a base hit. So Phelps becomes Seattle's first base runner. Ken at first base with no one out. And it will bring up Danny Tartable. The irony here is that when Dick Williams managed the Boston Red Sox in 1967, the year of the impossible dream, the year they won the pennant, Jose Tartable played for Williams. And now son Danny. And Danny's younger brother was drafted by Seattle, Jose, and he just signed. And he'll be going to the minors.
So he's not quite as big as Danny. But again, Danny has put on a lot of weight, a lot of strength. Yesterday, in fact, Friday night, hit a home run yesterday, took a high slider and just kind of wristed it over the fence and left here.
1-1. Update scores for you. Mets lead Houston in the 6th inning, 3-0. Montreal has the lead at Atlanta. Braves yesterday picked up Doyle Alexander. Phillies in the 6th lead Cincinnati 9-4. San Diego 1, Chicago nothing in the 2nd. Cards and the Giants and the Pirates and the Dodgers underway shortly. And in that giant St. Louis game, and we'll get to that in a moment as you look at the American League, where the White Sox lead New York 3-2 in the 3rd. Orioles Twins scoreless, and at Toronto, California leads 1-0. Tartable fouls it away.
Big trades up in Toronto. Doyle Alexander to Atlanta for Dwayne Ward. And are we correct about the other trade?
But what we hear this morning, Jim Acker for Joe Johnson, that is correct.
two major trades.
Tartable takes outside and the count 3-2. Well, the Braves think they can win the National League West. Anybody can win the National League West. Detroit and Texas, no score in the second. Cleveland leads Kansas City. Indians looking for their seventh in a row. And Milwaukee 3-0 over Oakland as Tartable fouls it away.
We talked to a lot of the Red Sox writers after seeing Toronto come up here and get, what, about 50 hits in 4 ball games. You have to think that they feel, even though they're, what, 11 and a half back, that Toronto can win.
There it is graphically, Doyle Alexander yesterday.
Doyle had requested a trade earlier in the year.
And Tartable takes low for 4. So the Mariners have runners at first and second with nobody out of the second inning. Boston on top, 1-0. And Scott Bradley is coming up.
Well, for a guy that's already struck out 75 times this year, talking about Danny Tartable, pretty good eye right there as Seaver misses low and away. And what Tom has to do is exactly what he hasn't done the last two hitters. He got behind Phelps, 2-1 fastball. He drilled at the right field. And after probably sitting on the bench watching Tartable in the last two games, knows he had to make a good pitch 3-2. You just don't throw it up there. This man hit 43 home runs last year, and now we see Scott Bradley.
Bradley, one of three catchers, with Steve Yeager and Bob Kearney the others. Bradley coming over from the White Sox for Ivan Calderon. He's been a Mariner now for about a week and a half.
Very confident young hitter.
In the air to left center field. It's Rice and Armas coming together, and Rice falls and makes the catch, and Phelps tags at second on his way to third, and he is in there. And so Rice and Armas converge, and you would think that Armas would have had the better chance here, but Rice called him off.
What he has, Al, is the better angle, also the better arm. And Phelps, not known for his speed, just gets in front of the tag. The reason that Danny Tartable stayed at first was that the excellent throw by Rice, and as far as it was right over Quinones' head at shortstop. Tartable tries to advance, no doubt will cut off the ball and get the second out at second.
Dave Henderson is the batter, and we've lost our center field camera for the moment. As it's popped up in foul territory, and this would be a big out if it remains playable, and it does for Stapleton. So two out. And Spike Owen coming up with runners at first and third. So Seaver gets now to work on the number 8 hitter, the switch hitting Owen, who comes up batting 262 with no homers and 21 runs batted in.
You can see from that graphic, basically a contact hitter, just likes the ball up and out over the strike zone, a switch hitter. Almost hit the same from both sides last year. Hit 6 home runs, 5 of them from the left side, so this is his more powerful side. Yesterday, a couple of base hits just on balls away, hit right back up the middle. But what Tom Seaver has done, as he has done so many times in his career, is get that key second out, and now he has to work on the third. First and third situation, if you don't get the double play or the strikeout, you want the pop-up, and he was able to do that. I think really, Al, that is the one thing that Tom has maintained, as most older pitchers don't, is still pretty good velocity on his fastball. He does not try to be the overpowering pitcher that he used to be. And if you look at his strikeouts, you can see this. But he can get the pop-up, can get the strikeout when he needs it.
Inside. 1-1 the count. Owen leading the league in triples with 6. Clocking thus far for Seaver, 91 miles per hour on the gun. One pitch to Owen is outside. 2-1 with Harold Reynolds on deck. 1-0 Boston, second inning. Red Sox won the opener of this series 6-5 on Friday night, and then the Mariners, with 17 hits yesterday, beat Boston 9-5.
big difference with Tom this year has been left-handed batters. They're hitting about 276 versus right-handers at 215. So this is a key pitch for him.
Broken bat, bouncer, foul. And so Owen goes back for a new piece of wood. And the count will be 2-2 with two out and two on. The Red Sox home for the balance of play before the All-Star break. Fenway Park, the site for this one today, and then tomorrow night on Monday Night Baseball, most of you will see Oakland and sensational rookie Jose Canseco coming in here to face the Red Sox with Roger Clemens on the mound. And what has Clemens done for the Red Sox lately? Huh? Here are the two games.
He's on a losing streak.
Yankees in Texas the other. Clemens 14-0 going into Wednesday night's game with Toronto and then beaten by the Blue Jays. As Owen goes down swinging, and Seaver ends the second inning with his third strikeout. Still Boston 1, Seattle nothing, end of 1.5. Okay. Boston leading Seattle by a score of 1-0. And Don Baylor talks about his years with the Yankees.
Well, I enjoy playing with the players on the field. There's no doubt about it. I thought I satisfied one particular man in the Yankee management, Mr. Steinbrenner, but I think I didn't. Somehow he just said I couldn't play against right-handed pitching, and that's his opinion, and I had my opinion, and I had a no trade to leave there, and which I did. And I tell you, I enjoyed New York. It's a great place to play. The fans were great to me. That's not the problem that I want to leave New York. Players are criticized for not wanting to play, making X amount of dollars, and I just asked to play every day, and that's all I wanted to do, and that's all I ever wanted to do.
Baylor extremely instrumental on and off the field in what the Red Sox have done this year. Kind of lost in the shuffle there is the fact that Mike Easler is also having a great year for the Yanks. Turned out to be a pretty good trade for both teams, at least numbers-wise. Well, the Red Sox would not turn down the opportunity again to deal for Baylor as Evans takes up high, whereas the Yankees might think again about sending Baylor away and especially about sending Baylor to Boston.
That's the unusual thing about the trade. A guy that has tremendous bat speed, is a full hitter in a park that's built for a right-handed full hitter. Kind of an unusual trade. Usually don't trade inside your division.
2-1 on Dwight Evans. Evans has had a real rough time. As you look at Ozzie Virgil Sr., and that's his youngest son off his left shoulder. And the eldest son, Ozzie Jr., is the Atlanta catcher. And we would assume it is Virgil who is managing the team since the ejection of Dick Williams, Ozzie, the third base coach. 2-1 pitch. Evans swinging and missing in the count 2-2.
Ozzie down in San Diego with Dick, and when he resigned from that job, took him right to Seattle.
And Evans goes down on strikes. And Evans' woes against left-handed pitching continues. Dwight coming into the game hitting 188, surprisingly, against lefties.
Number 20, Tony Armand.
Well, the good breaking ball, as we said, the slider usually uses it to the right-handers, tries to run it inside, and he does that. Dwight swings right through it.
Tony Armas, now the everyday center fielder. He's been bothered by injuries. Steve Lyons saw a lot of the action in center field early on, and then it was Lyons who went to the White Sox in the Tom Seaver deal as Armas fouls it back. So Tony, hopefully for the Red Sox, will be in the lineup the rest of the way, and also hopefully for the Red Sox, will start to increase his power production. Uncharacteristically, only 3 home runs so far for him this year.
Well, he's had leg problems last year, said it's still bothering him, an ankle problem this year, and talking to him, he feels a lot more confident, but not as far as hitting home runs. When you think of Tony Armas, you think of a guy that hit 43 2 years ago, last year missing close to 60 games, hit 23. Not quite because of these leg problems, the center fielder that he used to be when he was with Oakland, or even here a couple of years ago.
Langston's 0-2 pitch is a half swing foul, and it stays nothing and two. One out with the bases empty in the bottom of the second inning. Red Sox on top 1-0.
Again, traditionally, how we talked about Jim Rice maybe cutting down on his swing a little bit, trying to go the other way. Tony traditionally strikes up well over 100 times, only 41 times this year. So you wonder if he's making a conscious effort. I don't really think so. I just think it's the fact of being platooned early in the year with Steve Lyons, who was sent to Chicago in the Tom Seaver deal. And now a matter of getting some at-bats. Earlier, he was playing exclusively against left-handed pitchers. Now he's facing both right-handers and left-handers.
Breaking pitch is hit foul. And still a ball and two strikes. Fewest home runs. Milwaukee at 50, the White Sox at 55, and then the Red Sox with 58 home runs. And they have not finished among the bottom three in 25 years. Is reaching for it and lifting it to left center field. Bradley comes in and Phil makes the play with two down. If somebody would have showed you that particular statistic after spring training, you would have figured, okay, the Red Sox are going to wind up where everybody expects, fifth or sixth. But here they are with only 58 home runs. And I say only because in this ballpark, it's hard to be in the bottom three simply because of the confines of Fenway, and yet the Red Sox lead the East by 7. Mark Sullivan, son of Haywood Sullivan, the Red Sox chief executive and chief operating officer and one-time catcher. Sullivan, the backup to Rich Gedman. Foul away.
Go back to that May 15th game. The only hit that Mark Langston gave up was a home run to Mark Sullivan, who is not known as a power hitter. Good receiver. Exceptional size for a catcher, kind of a Carlton Fisk mold. Well over 6'4". Going back to what you said about looking at the home run output by the Red Sox, you would think they would be fifth or sixth. Yet, they are second in the American League in pitching, right behind Milwaukee.
And they were first until yesterday. 1-2, the count remains to Sullivan.
Team earned run average has crept up from really about 3 weeks, a month ago. It was down almost right around 3 runs a game, 3.10. Now it's at 3.70. And we talked about how easy it is to give runs up here in Fenway Park.
2-2. That's why it would be amazing if the Red Sox were to lead the league in earned run average. It would be almost as amazing as if the Cubs were to lead the National League playing in Wrigley with the wind blowing out as much as it does. Three and two.
You saw that ball ricochet out of Scott Bradley's glove. Very close pitch. I think he really felt that was strike three. A lot of times you'll just kind of put your glove there and hope the umpire will make the call.
Out of play, and still 3-2.
As big as a catcher's glove is, you can place the ball on the corner. The ball can hit the glove on the corner, and the ball can hit off the edge of it. Just kind of roll away, and occasionally you'll get a strike that really isn't a strike. Looked like that was Scott Bradley tried to do. Call that framing. Of course, you try to catch the ball sometimes too.
Away. He didn't frame that third strike to Stapleton particularly.
This ball is a little bit in the dirt. Get an idea of how what kind of stuff that Langston has. He's not afraid to throw his breaking ball 3-2. We've seen two pitches in a row, full count. Normally you go with your best thing, which is your fastball. He just says, I'll throw a fastball or a slider or a curveball or a changeup.
Langston. He's won his last 5 starts. He's won 7 of his last 8 decisions.
It seems like every year you have a pitcher. Last year, Mike Moore, 17-10 for the Mariners. The year before, Langston. They either come up with injuries or they don't pitch as well.
In the air to left center field. Crowd thought it was going a lot further than it turns out as the catch is made by Moses to retire the side. Three up, three down. Boston one, Seattle nothing as we go to the third.
He's 14-1 and baseball's hottest pitcher. Roger Clemens is scheduled to start as Boston takes on Oakland or the New York Yankees at Texas on ABC's Monday Night Baseball.
This is Corey McFerrin in New York. Latest on the Yankees and White Sox at Chicago. For Yankee fans, good news and bad news. First of all, the good news. First inning, Big Dave Winfield with this mammoth blast. This thing heading for the cheap seats in the upper deck. The Yankees lead 2-0. Bad news is the White Sox score three times in the second and once in the third. Chicago leads at 4-2, still in the third. Back to Al and Jim at Fenway.
Okay, Corey, and here Boston leads Seattle 1-0 as we go to the top of the third inning. And the number nine hitter, Harold Reynolds, to lead things off. Then John Moses and Phil Bradley. Harold Reynolds, one of three switch hitters in the Mariner lineup today. Started the season in the minors and came up on the 13th of May. In there for a strike. Dick Williams changed the ball club around when he took over for Chuck Cottier. And eventually it led to the releases of Al Cowens, Milt Wilcox, and Gorman Thomas as Reynolds hits a fly ball to center field. And Tony Armas puts it away. Williams wanted to get more contact and more speed and a little better defense in there. And so Moses and Reynolds were among those coming up. First inning, Barrett singled, stole second. Boggs grounded out, sending him to third. And Jim Rice was able to score Barrett with an RBI single, his 56th run batted in. John Moses. He hits it to center field. Armas comes sprinting in, but has to field this one on a hop. So a base hit. Hit number two off Tom Seaver, and the Mariners have a man at first with one out of the third inning. And Phil Bradley coming to the plate.
Dick Williams said Moses has been up and down. This is 29 years old, doing what he does best, which is to really hit the ball softly. He's not exactly a home run threat. He kind of hits the ball where he can. That ball, he just took a ball in the inside part of the plate, fought it off to short center field. No doubt Tony Armas will play a little bit shallower next time, unless the game situation dictates otherwise. Moses, one of those guys you want to really have the ball hit over your head if you're going to play percentage baseball.
Armas shading him a bit toward right. Moses with 11 steals. Reynolds is the team leader in steals with 19. They sent Moses. The pitch is low. Sullivan's throw, not in time. Good jump from Moses.
He's also been thrown out eight times. And right here, if Tom Seaver gives Mark Sullivan a chance, as Moses steals his base off Tom Seaver, Sullivan makes an excellent throw, just a little bit late. You see Marty Barrett take the throw right on the money. Talk about that 1.4 second. If you don't get the catcher the ball in 1.4 second, or if you let the base runner get a running lead, he's normally going to be successful, especially if he can run the bases like Moses can.
A little squibber right to Stapleton, and Moses has to get back to second. Bradley is out number two here in the third inning. Presley is coming up, and next Saturday on Wide World of Sports, the WBA World Junior Heavyweight Championship, Dwight Muhammad Kwawi against Evander Holyfield. Kwawi making his second title defense, and Holyfield trying to become the first of those on the 1984 U.S. Olympic boxing team to win a world title. In fact, he's the first man to challenge for a world title. Been a rapid ascent for Evander Holyfield, and you'll see him next week on Wide World against Kwawi. Presley fouls it away in the count 0-1.
Time and time again already in this ballgame, Tom Seaver has made the big pitch when he's had to. Second inning, gets the pop-up with Dave Henderson. Breaks Owens' bat. Sends sends him back to dugout for another one, and then on a slider up and in, and then goes away with a fastball. Bradley, a jam shot to first base. One thing about Tommy is never ever been a thrower. Came up to the major leagues very early age out of SC. Could always make what we call quality pitches. Kind of joke now, they deem a quality start where you go six innings and give up three runs or less, or three runs. That means your earned run average is about 4.50. That's not exactly a quality start when you look at a guy like Tom Seaver and go back and look in the record books. Many alternatives on the mound.
Ground ball backhanded beautifully by Boggs and throws it out by three steps.
A wonderful play. Comes up and throws him out a lot quicker than he has to. Talk about the 376 batting average, but the biggest improvement Wade Boggs has done with his defense. And here's a perfect example. Backhands it, gets up and throws him out. He gets a third out.
You thought he was a one-dimensional player, huh? Well, it's almost time for the All-Star game. In fact, a week from Tuesday, we'll be at the Astrodome in Houston, and you will see it right here on ABC at 8 Eastern, 7 Central, and 5 Pacific time. Update for you, Mets leading Houston 3-1 in the 7th, Montreal 10, Atlanta 7 in the 6th inning, the Phillies leading Cincinnati 9-5 in the 8th, San Diego 1, the Cubs nothing in the 3rd, Cards, Giants, Pirates, Dodgers later. White Sox lead the Yanks 4-2 fourth inning. Baltimore leading in the 7th at Minnesota. California in the 4th leads Toronto 1-0. Tigers, Rangers tied in the 4th. Cleveland 2-0 in the 8th over KC. And Milwaukee leading Oakland 3-2 in the 6th inning. Ray Quiñones leads things off, taking a strike in the count 0-1. Quiñones, the number 9 hitter, then Marty Barrett and Wade Boggs facing Mark Langston as Quiñones tries to bunt his way on. They appeal at first base to see if they get the call there and don't from Tim Welke, who says he did not commit. 1-1. Beautifully short hop by Presley. And so back-to-back fine plays by the two third basemen. That one hit right to him, but a tough play nonetheless.
Well, another example of a non-one-dimensional player, I suppose. Presley with 17 home runs. Falls the ball right into his glove. And again, if you're playing third, it's really, they call it a two-step position at most. There, he didn't have to take a step at all.
Marty Barrett, who has scored the only run of the game, takes a strike. His average now up to 297, and his hitting streak at 13 after the first inning single.
On his first full year with the Red Sox, hit over 300 last year, around 266. This year, if you pitch him away, he pings it to right quick enough, as he did in the first inning, to drill the ball by the third baseman. You already saw a stolen base, so he can bunt. You have to play him close, so he can drive the ball by you if you come up at third base.
The man who makes contact, Barrett, has struck out only 13 times all season, and he plays every day. Langston's been on a strikeout tear of late. In his last four starts, he has struck out 40 in 28 innings in there. And today, he has struck out 2 2⅓. Langston, who led the league in strikeouts as a rookie in 84, runs it down and in and gets another strikeout. So Barrett K's for only the 14th time this year.
We talked about that slider. Two strikes. Sometimes expand the strike zone. You see the ball run down and in. Marty Barrett swings right over it. In fact, if you go back to 1984, first time since 1955 when Herb Score and Sam Sad Jones did it, you had two rookies, Dwight Gooden in the National League and Mark Langston in the American League, leading the league in strikeouts.
Wade Boggs has had a tough time, obviously, as you look at the graphic with Langston, 0-4-11, and he's the man who has not had a tough time with very many pitchers. But As you take a look there, you've got Matt Young, number two at 1-for-18. Young is now the closer for Seattle. But Fox hits this one in the air to left field, right to Bradley. And so he is now 0-for-12 lifetime against Langston. Red Sox ahead 1-0 through three.
ABC Sunday Afternoon Baseball is brought to you by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light.
Wade Boggs made that great play to end the top of the third. All-Star game coming up, and the thoughts of Boggs about playing in Houston.
It's a great opportunity as far as a ball player to be in a spectacle like that. You always dream about it when you're little and watch it on TV, all the All-Star games. And last year being the first one that I attended, tremendous enjoyment out of it.
So Wade Boggs, he'll be in Houston. There's no question about that. But since the fans picked the starters, and you've got a fellow who's played third base in Kansas City for a few years on top in the voting, it would figure to be George Brett getting the start. But I'm sure Boggs will see some action.
No doubt. Only if the American League wants to win.
You know, actually, Brett's been on the shelf for a few days here with a slight injury as Phelps stands in. So if that developed into anything more than we assume it is, you could have the case of Boggs making the start in George's place. 1-0 the count on Phelps as Seaver loses his cap but gets it in for a strike in the count 1-1.
Thought Jim Bouton was making a comeback. The hat goes. It's a great way to deceive a hitter, have your hat fall off in the middle of your delivery. Kind of get the message. Seaver has tried to get Phelps out with breaking balls all day. That's two in a row. The slider missed, so that's three breaking balls in a row, and we're back to the same count that Phelps had the first time where he took a fastball in the middle of the plate and singled to right.
Got the corner. Two and two.
Tom took something off his fastball, and that, you saw Tom, as I did in 1969 in the World Series, 2-1, here's my best stuff. Now he just kind of turns the ball over or cuts it. As we said, come off with a slow curveball. Very crafty. And he has the good velocity when he needs it. Phelps, yesterday's game, hit a home run into the net off Bob Stanley. So not only can he pull the ball with authority, he can go the other way. As can Jim Presley, who we saw made the outstanding play at third base. 17 home runs for Presley.
Still 2-2 on Phelps. He'll be followed by Tartable and Scott Bradley.
When you look, and again going back, and you look at Danny Tartable on deck, and look at Seaver's career, as I did last week in looking at Nolan Ryan's career, is that to pitch as long as Tom Seaver have, or Nolan Ryan, or Jerry Kuzman, who retired after last year, you have to use your legs as part of the pitching mechanics, and Seaver does it as well as anybody.
Fly ball to right center field. Armas tells Evans he'll take it. Phelps is gone. One away in the fourth inning. Seaver, through three and a third, has given up singles to Phelps and Moses. Those have been the only two Mariner hits. He's walked one, and he has three strikeouts. Tartable drew a walk in the second inning. Seaver now with 3,573 career strikeouts, trailing only Nolan Ryan and Steve Carlton on the all-time strikeout list. And Carlton, by the way, just about now going to the mound in San Francisco to take on the St. Louis Cardinals. That's become the Seaver trademark right there. The dirty right pant leg. Tom almost uses that as a barometer as to whether or not he's his mechanics are precise.
Well, a lot of pitchers have a checkpoint in their delivery. Of course, Tom, you could just see the knee bounces. a knee pad or with some kind of bandaging around that knee. A lot of pitchers do it on their foot that they push off the pitching rubber with. You see a transgressor come out on the field and sneak away with a baseball. But I think it has a lot to do with Rube Walker, who used to be the pitching coach. An old-time catcher that was a pitching coach for the Mets. Taught that kind of delivery to Gary Gentry. Ryan Kuzman. Again, what it does, it allows you to use your whole body and take strain off your arm. And to pitch over 4,500 innings, which Tom Seaver has done, it's a good idea not to throw with your arm only. I saw in Houston last year, just came off the disabled list, Charlie Kerfel. He recoils, doesn't use his body at all, hence a lot of arm injuries. Seaver had some shoulder injuries early in the year, but that is very unusual. Tom has had hip problems, back problems, leg problems, but very rarely anything to do with the arm.
To center field, arm is going back on it and has room on the warning track. So both Phelps and Tarnable have fly to center here in the fourth inning, and Scott Bradley comes up.
And Tony making this play easily. He's known as one of the better right fielders when he played for Oakland. Ricky Henderson in left, Dwayne Murphy in center, Tony Armas in right.
They did chase down a few.
And when they caught him, they could throw you out.
Armas again. So put down 3-8 in the scorebook. Mariners got an order. Boston 1, Seattle nothing after 3.5.
The Braves chipping away against the Expos. This is Corey McFerrin in New York. Montreal had been up 10-2. It's now 10-7, thanks mainly to this man, Bob Horner. Two on, fifth inning, and there it goes. Horner, the big story. Three at-bats, three home runs, and five ribbies. But the Expos still lead 10-7 in the bottom of the sixth inning.
Well, a reminder, next weekend, the U.S. Women's Open Golf Championship. Kathy Baker is the defending champion. Pat Bradley, the leading money winner on the tour this year. Third round Saturday, 2:30 Eastern, and then final round action on Sunday at 3:30 Eastern. The U.S. Women's Open next weekend. Bottom of the fourth, Boston leads Seattle 1-0 as Dave Stapleton fouls it back. 0-1.
Another reason Dave Stapleton is playing today instead of Billy Buckner. Said last year, unusually, Buckner, an outstanding hitter over his career, hit almost 300 left against left-handers. This year, hitting about 196. So, I suppose if you're going to rest him, why not rest him against one of the toughest left-handers in the league? A man that's, as you said, on a roll, five in a row, a lot of strikeouts. Not a bad day to rest Rich Gedman either.
McNamara wants to begin to start resting some regulars. It's getting to be that time of year. And the Red Sox with a seven-game margin. The only oddity, as I said before, is the fact that Stapleton gets the start and McNamara inserts him in the number three spot. That's Buckner's position. And Billy, a prototypical number three hitter, but here's a man who's coming in today, had 9 at-bats all season.
I think the reason, though, is that you have to figure when you have a Marty Barrett who's on a hot streak with a 13-game hitting streak, you have a guy hitting behind him, Wade Boggs, is hitting somewhere around 375. Those two guys are going to get on base, and one thing that Dave Stapleton can do is hit the ball the other way. Traditionally, you like to have a high average hitter for your third hitter, but Stapleton can hit behind the runners. Has not played in recent years because of a lot of leg injuries.
Breaking pitch, called strike three. So he throws him a breaking ball, 3-2, and down he goes.
You see a much more different motion than Tom Seaver, much more upright, high leg kick versus the low leg kick. And again, using really his arm more than he does his legs, very much in a style that I pitched. Would have always liked to have thrown like Seaver, never could pull it off.
1-0. What would happen when you would try?
I just wouldn't have the velocity, and I guess I pitched so much with my wrist. It's a very kind of a flippy type of pitcher, elongated wrist movement, which gave me the high riding fastball. And I think the big difference between a Mark Langston and a Tom Seaver that we're seeing today is where they pitch in the strike zone. Langston pitches up in the strike zone. Seaver, to be successful, even though he was up last inning, has to be down. You go back and look at your inning, and I'm sure Tom is sitting over on the bench saying, wait a minute, three batters, three fly balls to center field. If you had your druthers in Fenway Park, you'd rather have them hit it on the ground. High grass, very slow infield, and a very short left field porch.
1-2 on Rice. They used to talk about Rice having the greatest bat speed in the league. Now they're beginning to talk about the Oakland rookie, Jose Canseco, as surpassing Rice.
Well, the way you speed up Jim Rice's bat is to throw him an off-speed pitch, especially a slider. If you're behind the fastball with a slider, maybe 8 to 9 miles per hour slower, you get the bat head out. If you want to see some long fly balls to left field, as a right-handed pitcher, throw a hanging slider to Jim Rice. The bat head will get out there in a hurry.
Rice, 56 points higher a year later, but look at the home runs. Half as many as he had at this time last year. One hopper fielded by Owen as he short hops it, and Spike throws him out. So Rice hits it sharply, but he's gone.
It's one of those sliders we were talking about. You foul off the fastball, get the hitter behind it, as you see Spike Owens right down on the ball, looks to see if he still has it. Most difficult play for an infielder is a ball hit right at him that skips right in front of him, and you see the strong throw for the out. I think, though, this man right here will probably allow Jim Rice to feel more comfortable about hitting for an average and going the other way. Suppose that last year felt that he needed to hit more home runs. This year, 335 going into today's game, feel more comfortable about just hitting for the average.
Baylor hits it high and deep, and if it's fair, it's out of here, but it is hooking and going foul. Hit that one over the top of the foul pole. And Langston can afford a slight grin. Is it simply a long strike? Shallow right center field. Carnival comes racing in with Reynolds going out, and Reynolds makes it look easy. And Reynolds can afford to smile after that near disaster. Three up and three down for Boston. Jim Rice in left field for Boston. And before the game, he talked about his diminished home run production.
While out playing this ballpark, I have 8 home runs now. With the way things are going, or the way it has been going with me, I could have had about 20 home runs already, because I think I lead the league in doubles, and I've hit about at least 15 of them off the wall. So any other ballpark, they would have been home runs. But unfortunately, I'm playing here in Fenway Park, and I'm just happy to be here, and I'm just happy to be where I'm at right now.
Dave Henderson leads off in the fifth inning.
Of course, what Jim is alluding to is that he hits a lot of balls, and the left field fence here is 39 feet high. That would be home runs in other ballparks, but he hits them so hard on the line that a lot of them are ultimately doubles, and some of them are singles.
Well, it would be a real cause celeb here in Boston and around baseball if the Red Sox were not doing as well as they are. I mean, it's one thing to have only 8 homers and have your team 7 in front. It's another. Let's say the Red Sox would 12 out and Rice had 8 homers, everybody would be saying, what's wrong with Jim Rice?
Well, Jim has always had a love-hate relationship up here. A very nice guy, but very quiet. And last year it was a double plays. Other years it's been the defense, even though he's improved in that area. So I think it's really a man that is very talented, lifetime 300 hitter going into this season, that cannot please all the people all the time. Arthroscopic knee surgery last year, a year that most guys would kill to have, yet it wasn't satisfactory up here in Boston. three balls and one strike. You paint the corner, and Seaver's been doing that all day.
Shallow center. Barrett goes out. And he makes the play. Henderson gone. Tom Seaver has set down six straight and 10 of the last 11. And it brings up Spike Owen.
It's interesting. Tom is doing what a lot of power pitchers learn to do, which is to get strikeouts when you need them. They've talked about the fact that Dwight Gooden, even though he is 10-3 this year, is not the pitcher he was last year because he's not striking out as many batters. And Dwight's saying, well, why expend all that energy and all those wasted pitches when I can get a ground ball or a pop-up?
In there. Despite Gooden not being as good as people some expect in 1986, he's got a good chance to wind up as the starting pitcher in the All-Star game.
And Whitey Herzog, you have a couple of choices. Mike Scott is pitching extremely well. Mike Kruko up in San Francisco, yeah, won his 10th game the other day.
Well, there'll be some sentimental pressure to start Scott since the game is in Houston.
Well, also the split finger fastball might have something to do with it.
Owen rips it to the gap in right center field for a base hit. Armas cuts it off, and Owen is held to a single. And that's the third hit off Tom Seaver. They've all been singles, and he has scattered them. Phelps leading off in the second. Moses with one out of the third. And now Owen a one-out fifth inning single. Mets on their way to another win. Montreal leading despite three homers by Horner. And the Phillies lead the Reds in the eighth, 9-5. San Diego still in front, and they're underway at Candlestick and at Dodger Stadium. Harold Reynolds at the plate. White Sox lead in the sixth. Baltimore hanging on at the Metrodome, and California still leading at Exhibition Stadium. Tigers lead in the fifth. Cleveland in the ninth ahead 5-0. Milwaukee 3-2 over Oakland in the seventh. Two on Reynolds.
Reynolds, one of the three players that Dick Williams lets run on their own. Spike Owen at first is not.
To center field, Armas moving in and has it deflect off his glove. Owen is on his way to third as Reynolds moves towards second, and Canones is able to cut it off, but both men are safe and runners are at second and third. Owen had to hesitate as Tony Armas tried to decoy him in center field, but then wound up decoying himself, as it turned out.
Well, that's what causes the errors. He tries to decoy Owens. The illusion that he's going to catch the ball. He takes his eye off the ball to look at Owens. And the error. Aggressive running by Reynolds. As you said earlier, that's the reason he is in the lineup, to steal bases and to take the extra base when it's presented, and it certainly was there.
So it's a single and an error charge to Armas. And the Red Sox now are up in the infield at first and third, back at short and second, with Moses taking high, ball one. A look at how the Red Sox are positioned defensively with Boggs and Quiñones on the left side and Barrett and Stapleton on the right side.
Again, conceding the tying run, trying to keep the go-ahead run at second base from scoring.
Moses hits it in the air to left field. Rice is backing up. The runners are both tagging. Owen comes in to score. The throw coming in toward third. And Reynolds is safe there as Seattle ties it up in the fifth inning. So at least for the moment, the error by Arbus proves to be very instrumental on a sacrifice fly by Moses. A 1-1 tie with two out, and Reynolds now at third, and Bradley coming to the plate.
Your position, or the thing you try to do, is get a pitch you can hit. Less than two outs, a man on third, you can hit in the air. John Moses did that. Got a high fastball from Tom and just lofted it to left field, almost off the wall.
Bill Bradley, 0 for 2 today, takes a strike on the inside corner. Seattle, one run, four hits, and one error. Boston, one run, two hits, and one error. Reynolds at third, two down.
It's an interesting thing when you talk about Phil Bradley. You talked about no home runs, hitting 300 his first year, 26 home runs his second year. He also doubled the amount of strikeouts. So obviously, a little bit longer swing, situational hitter, learning the pitchers in the league. Talk to manager Dick Williams, he feels that Bradley's a better hitter when he doesn't try to swing for home runs and hit the ball the other way. Something he tried the last time up. He lined out to Stapleton at first.
Still a ball of two strikes. Harold Reynolds, the runner at third. Fifth inning. Fenway Park. Seaver and Langston, a 1-1 tie. And the 1-2. Tomorrow night, Monday Night Baseball, many of you will see Oakland against Boston, and Roger Clemens will be on the mound seeking his 15th win of the season against Jose Canseco and the Oakland A's, and others will see the Yankees against Texas. So check your local listings for the game in your area. It begins tomorrow night at 8 Eastern time here on ABC. Dwight Evans leads off as we go to the bottom of the fifth inning. Evans, Armas, and Sullivan against Mark Langston. Boston got a run in the first. The Mariners tied the game in the fifth. We go to the bottom of the fifth inning. One. Langston seeking his sixth consecutive victory. Came into the game with 40 strikeouts in 28 innings of work over his last four starts, and he's picked up four today in four innings thus far.
Well, most left-handers, don't like to come to Fenway Park, but when you have as many alternatives as Mark Langston, as far as talking about varieties of pitches and the ability to control them, that bad a ballpark to pitch it.
Three and one.
We've seen what Dwight Evans does so well last year. You see the unusual batting stance. Turns his left foot in, and in doing so, keeps his left shoulder in, which is a key to striding towards the pitcher instead of opening up too soon. But last year led the American League in walks with 114. Also 105 strikeouts. So a lot of full counts. Takes a lot of pitches. Doesn't mind hitting 3-2. Was contrary to Wade Boggs, who last year out of his 240 hits got 124 with two strikes. He's not that good at two-strike hitter.
And that's five strikeouts now for Mark Langston. That's not unusual the way he's been going. What's unusual, though, is his control today. He has not walked the batter.
Well, it is unusual, and talking to Phil Roof, who's the bullpen coach for the Mariners, he said he sometimes pitches a little bit above his ability, and I said, what do you mean? He says, well, he overthrows. He tries to throw too hard, and as we said, the four excellent pitches, but when you overthrow your fastball, a lot of times you lose control and life on it.
Armas takes a breaking pitch for a strike, 0-1.
He's retired 11 in a row, and it seems like he's gotten his feet on the ground. Hit by Rice for the first run and Barrett single to start the game. Other than that, very few mistakes today.
Langston throwing in the low 90s, that last pitch coming up at 93.
Again, as a hitter, you go up there, you can't look for any one pitch. He has four and he'll use them at any time.
Still 0-2. Sullivan on deck, one out. Base is empty. Bottom of the fifth inning. Boston and Seattle, 1-1 in Fenway.
Good night, Tony.
1-2. Langston walking five in each of his last two starts. They resulted in victories. And today he's walked nary a batter. Broken bat, soft squibber to Reynolds, who has to charge and shovel and get him. And that's two down here in the fifth inning.
Well, another example of Reynolds' great speed. We saw it last inning to end the inning for the Mariners when he went deep into right field to catch a pop fly. The Tartar ball sliding under him. I think that's one of the reasons also that they went to Reynolds instead of Jack Percani, who was the second baseman for most of the year last year with Seattle, is speed. They play on an AstroTurf field. Somebody that is quick on their feet, can steal bases. And Harold Reynolds can do that for you.
1-0 on Mark Sullivan, the Boston catcher. Flied out of the second inning. 1-1.
And Sullivan, the only hit in Langston's first game here in Fenway Park in 1985. Game where he gave up one run in seven innings. One hit. Dr. Palmer will tell you what his injury problem was last year, the flexor tendons, a group of tendons that come out of your wrist and connect to the medial epicondyle, which is in your elbow, bottom part of your elbow. It's really the opposite of tennis elbow.
So what's the remedy?
Rest, medication, exercise, and that's the one thing he talked about. I talked to Mark before the game. He said he's been on an exercise program all year, and he has never thrown better as far as velocity on his fastball, and he's never felt more confident.
2-2 on Sullivan.
It's only his third year in the major leagues. First year as a rookie, won 17. Second year was injured, struggled to a 7-14 record.
Rookie year, a real Quinella for him, led the league in walks and strikeouts. And strike three here. That's six strikeouts now. And he's retired 13 straight. And we'll be back after this from your local stations.
Baseball's hottest, brightest, sharpest and steadiest stars in the All-Star Game, July 15th on ABC Sports.
The Mets about to win 3 of 4 from the Astros. First of all, seventh inning, two out, one on. Howard Johnson gets a run on this fastball, drives it to the pen in left field. The Mets in command 5-1. It's now 5-3 in the ninth. If the Mets hang on, Cid Fernandez will become the first 11-game winner in the National League.
Michaels and Jim Palmer with you. We go to the sixth inning in Boston as Jim Presley starts things for Seattle. 1-0 the count. Presley, Phelps, and Tartable. Game tied 1-1. Tom Seaver, who has struck out four, Clemens will be going tomorrow night against Dave Stewart and the Oakland A's. Trying to get another winning streak started. Clemens is 14-1, and tomorrow night's game will be exactly the halfway mark of the season for Boston. Barrett singled and stole second, moved up when Boggs grounded out, and Rice brought him in with a base hit. Then in the fifth, Owen with a base hit, Reynolds with a single, and the ball deflecting off Armas's glove, sending Owen to third, and Moses tied the game with a sac fly.
Breaking ball from Tom, and as great as the season Roger Clemens has had, again, you get the idea of how important it is to, as a pitcher, to have your team play well. They've supported him very well. At one point, we're averaging close to 7 runs a game when he goes out there. So he's done his job, and defensively and offensively, the Red Sox have done there.
Good breaking pitch. 5 strikeouts to Tom Seaver. Presley goes down for the second time today and the 86th time this season.
Well, I don't care how long you've pitched, if you get ahead and then throw a good breaking ball just out of the strike zone, a hitter maybe will expand the strike zone, especially a hitter like Jim Presley. Tom gets ahead, throws the ball just off the corner, gets another strikeout.
Phelps has singled and fly to center.
Really a difference, Al, of listening to your pitching coach and having him drum that into your head when you're a rookie or your second year, is that you don't really know that that's true. But if you're a Tom Seaver and you've pitched as many innings as he has, which is well over 4,500, you know, he knows at this point in his career he can't pitch from behind the hitters. If he does, he has to throw changeups and breaking balls. He can't get away with his fastball. So it makes it a lot easier when he gets ahead of the hitters.
Phelps grounds it to Barrett. Coming to the plate. Just sitting here thinking, looking at Seaver. Seaver is one of 4 active 300-game winners, and I say active because Carlton now is active again with the Giants, the others being Phil Negro and Don Sutton. And all of them have changed uniforms in the past year. Phil Negro with the Yankees a year ago and now Cleveland. Don Sutton with California right now and with Oakland last year at this time. Seaver going from the White Sox to the Red Sox as Tarnival drives one to right center field. Armas races back and makes the catch on the run. And Carlton now pitching for the Giants today. But Seaver keeps rolling here, and after 5.5, the game still tied 1-1.
He's 14-1 and baseball's hottest pitcher. Roger Clemens is scheduled to start as Boston takes on Oakland or the New York Yankees at Texas on ABC's Monday Night Baseball.
Take a look at Tony Armas now, tracking down that last out to end the top of the 6th inning.
Well, there are a lot of doubting Thomases up here in Boston about Boston's ability to win and keep the lead that they've established in the American League East. And one of them is the defensive capabilities, Armas in center field. And earlier in the year, they pointed to the fact that Steve Lyons was put in for defensive replacements. But part of that play right there, Al, is positioning of your defense. And Seaver is pitching Tartabull away. If you're going to do that, you have to play him in right center, and Armas was over there and made the play really rather easily. Didn't look like a guy with bad legs or bad wheels, as they say.
Again, you saw the tennis result. If you missed it, Boris Becker winning his second straight Wimbledon, taking care of Yvonne Lendl today in straight sets. Ray Quiñones leading off in the bottom of the 6th.
Very closely contested Wimbledon, as this game is, and right now, the only mistake for the Red Sox has been the error by Armas. And for Langston, really leadoff single, and then the pretty good pitch to Rice that he kind of fisted into right field.
Quiñones bluffing a bunt. Quiñones snapped an 0-for-23 streak yesterday. McNamara's going to go with him, apparently, for the better part of the second half. He's got Ed Romero, who we can use as well, and Glenn Hoffman. The longtime shortstop has been on the disabled list for most of the season. So Quiñones could be a key factor.
Well, they like his glove. They're a little disappointed with his bat. And you talk to the Red Sox front office. office or anybody, they say this is the guy that Ted Williams thinks has one of the best strokes in the minor league. So far this year, he hasn't been able to show it.
Langston gives up his first walk and only the second walk of the game. The other issued by Seaver to Tarnable in the second inning. And Marty Barrett comes to the plate.
Go back to that walk by Seaver. There's a reason. He got behind him. He knows that Tarnable, after watching him homer both on Friday and Saturday, his capabilities of hitting the ball out of the ballpark. Kionis has not been swinging the bat well, and if you're going to get yourself into trouble, you can do it by walking the ninth hitter and getting to a guy that's on a 13-game hitting streak.
And Barrett tries to bunt him along and fouls it away.
Because Marty Barrett, of all the Red Sox, handles the bat the best as far as hitting behind the runner. So you do have some options, some alternatives if you're managing, or if you're the hitter, Marty Barrett. He's a better right fielder and hitter on this ball club than Marty Barrett.
Up there to bunt again and lays this one down foul. So Barrett now with a count 0-2, which severely limits your options.
That it does. Sitting at home, they're saying, why can't he bunt? And the reason is he's usually not asked very often to do this. As a manager, you have to know the strengths of your players.
Barrett with six sacrifices this season, but up there now, he was squaring again with two strikes and takes outside 1-2.
Remember, for years in Baltimore, when I played for Earl Weaver, he would first and second situation late in the ball game in a bunt situation. Knowing that he didn't want to do it, he would try to bunt with Gary Renicky. Well, Gary Renicky never used to have to bunt, therefore he couldn't do it.
Close play.
You see a move they've almost nicknamed, and I'll do it today, the Dave Righetti move. Just kind of back off the rubber and the quick throw to first, almost catch Quinones off the base.
Still 1-2. Second. Happens so often, a guy goes up there to bunt, can't advance the man, swings away, base hit.
Just a routine ground ball, but Owen up the middle, playing the percentages. Ball's to his right, and he can't get to it.
Now first and second with nobody out, and here is Wade Boggs. Lefty against lefty. If Fox is ever going to bunt, and he has only one sacrifice this year, this would be the time. He's 0 for 12 lifetime. Tie game, first and second, and nobody out.
As a pitcher, you don't know if he is going to bunt or not, as he does square around.
Langston goes to third. No, not in time. And the speed of throw.
That's exactly right, Al. You have to get hope from your catcher. Langston feels the ball as you see Quinones running to third. Comes up firing. And he's safe by a smidgen. Langston did everything right. Right here, he's made up his mind. Even though he should be getting some help, as you see Bradley pointing first. But in his mind, he felt that he could get the lead runner and didn't.
That's a sacrifice and a fielder's choice, and Stapleton fouls it away. So the Red Sox have loaded the bases with nobody out. We're tied 1-1 in the bottom of the sixth inning. Stapleton has struck out twice today.
That is something, though, from the booth. You see Scott Bradley pointing to first, but did he yell loud enough? In Fenway Park, with looking around, maybe close to 33,000 people here.
Shallow left field. Bradley comes in, makes the catch, and Quinones has to hold, as do all the runners. So Stapleton, a shallow fly ball. Not deep enough to get the man in. One away, and now a great ground ball possibly gets you out of the inning. With Rice at the plate.
But this, if you had your brothers as a pitcher, this is not when you want to face a guy that's hitting 335 going into the game. But Langston there, just Stapleton up, knows he's more or less a spray hitter, just came up and in. Little pop fly.
1-0 on Rice.
I think the big difference when you look at Jim Rice over the course of this year, less home runs, higher average, is that he's more patient. A lot of times we'll chase bad pitches in the past.
Way outside. So Langston is really digging himself a hole now. 2-0 and has to come in with this one.
For both average and power.
3-0. Rice doesn't get too many take signs, but in this particular instance, if he's ever going to get one, this is the spot. And he takes high for ball four. Steaming at Voltaggio as the Red Sox take a 2-1 lead. And now Langston way out of rhythm, and Phil Regan goes to the mound to try to settle him down. Langston upset with the umpire, upset with himself, and ready to go to work on Baylor as Mark Usman, the former Royal, begins to throw in the Seattle bullpen.
As we talked about earlier, the one thing you want to do here at Fenway Park is stay away from the big inning. And Mark Langston, because of the leadoff walk and inadvertently throwing to the wrong base, is looking at a big inning situation.
Baylor fouls it away, and the count is 0-1. Jim Rice has driven in both Red Sox runs today, and he now has 57 RBIs for the season.
Too hits into a lot of double plays because he hits the ball so sharply.
He's already hit into one today. Got the corner. 0-2. Bases loaded with Barrett, the runner at third. Boggs takes his lead at second. Rice at first. One out. Sixth inning. 2-1 Boston. And it's grounded to Presley, who drops the ball and has no play. Instead of a double play, it's 3-1. Exactly what Langston wanted, but Presley couldn't do anything with it.
Well, our colleague Tim McCarver talks about staying below the hop. Perfect double play ball. The ball stays down. Presley comes up. Ball hits off the side of his glove, takes his eye off it. I think with Jim Rice at first base would have been a very difficult play to turn two on because of Rice's big lead at first not being held on. But if you're ever going to do it, it's a pretty good ball to try to turn a double play on.
Seattle leading the league in errors. That's their second of the game. And their 81st of the season. That's about one a day.
Go back and look at this inning. Your Dick Williams, when he came over, we talked about giving everybody a rule book. The one thing managers do not like are mental mistakes, and the going to third base instead of getting the easy out at first is a mental mistake. The physical mistake we just saw by Jim Presley will happen. Normally a pretty good fielding third baseman just didn't make that play, but the walk to Quiñones and going to the wrong base is something you don't want to have see happen as a manager.
Owen shovels the Reynolds back to first, so they get the double play. But after the Red Sox get two, and at the end of six, 3-1 Boston.
ABC Sunday Afternoon Baseball is brought to you by Coors and Coors Light. Beers with a difference worth tasting.
Sullivan as he wins the Cleveland Grand Prix today. He won at the Meadowlands last week with Michael Andretti and Father Mario finishing second and third, and then Mears in fourth. Next week on ABC's Wide World of Sports, next Saturday, 4:30 Eastern and Pacific, Dwight Muhammad Kwawi defending his World Junior Heavyweight Championship, the WBA version, against Evander Holyfield, the 1984 Olympian, in quest of a title. Here in Boston, we go to the seventh inning as Scott Bradley runs up the bunt, takes outside, ball one. Bradley, Henderson, and Owen against Tom Seaver. Now with a two-run lead, 3-1 Boston in the seventh. Stapleton, the Seaver cover. One out.
Well, Tom doing exactly what he said he would wanted to do when he came over from the White Sox. Go out there and pitch at least seven innings, hold the other team to three runs or less, and so far, six and a third innings, has been able to do that. So when you go out and pitch against Toronto, one of the better hitting ball clubs, especially over the last week. And to me, if you go back and look at the Red Sox, they went to Baltimore last weekend, swept a weekend series. Toronto comes in, playing very well. They win the first two games, and then they have Clemens and Boyd on the mound for a sweep, and they lose both ball games. So just when you think you have this game figured out, something like that happens.
Henderson hits it in the air to left field, and Rice comes in and makes the play. Seaver has now retired seven in a row. Earlier, he had set down six in a row. And Spike Owen comes up. Owen has struck out and singled. At San Francisco, Steve Carlton has not allowed a run through two. At the end of one and a half, the Giants and St. Louis are scoreless.
It's another question, wherever you go, do you think Carlton can still pitch? I said, I think he still wants to. The only thing that bothered me about the year that he's had was the wildness. And contrary to a guy like Tom Seaver, Steve, with what, about 318 lifetime wins, really has to be successful, has to throw enough strikes so he can pitch out of the strike zone. Always been known for that great slider, get ahead of the hitters and then get the strikeout pitch down and out of the strike zone. This year he hadn't been able to do it so far. So it'll be interesting with Roger Craig, the manager, the guru of the new pitch of the 80s, the split-fingered fastball. Maybe we'll be able to help Steve Carlton.
When you talk about Carlton's control, it almost has to be noted with an asterisk. He got, through the years, so many of his strikeouts on pitches out of the strike zone.
Again, like what Tom has done all day today is he's gotten ahead. Carlton couldn't do that this year. Seaver's been able to do it now.
Barrett throws out Owen. Tom has retired eight in a row. After six and a half, it's 3-1 Boston. Back after this for your local station. Sid Fernandez wins his 11th today as the Mets beat Houston. Montreal leads Atlanta. Three homers for Bob Horner, but the Braves trail. Phillies beat Cincinnati 12-5. Seventh inning, 2-1 San Diego leads Chicago. Carlton works against Cox, no score, second Candlestick. Dodgers 2, Pittsburgh nothing. In the third, White Sox lead the Yankees in the eighth. Baltimore shuts Minnesota out. California leads Toronto 3-1 in the seventh inning. Detroit leads Texas 4-1 in the sixth inning. Cleveland wins again against reeling Kansas City as Armas fouls it back out of play. 0-1. That's seven straight victories for Cleveland, and nine in a row now that the Royals have dropped. And in the bullpen, it's Joe Sambito for the Red Sox. The deep left field, and gone.
Tony Armas tones for his what you do is you get everybody's attention. And you get Mark Langston's attention in a hurry. It's one of those hanging, breaking balls that you just, if you're pitching, turn around and follow.
In a lot of ballparks, you hit one to deep left, and it's back, 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 or the outfielder goes to the track to the fence. But here, very little doubt. Sullivan popping it to Presley. One away. Harmitz hits his fourth homer of the season. Only his second home run at Fenway Park this year. And the Red Sox on top 4-1.
Again, Tony is not what you'd call a pull hitter. But he will get a mistake, which he got right there. A high breaking ball up in the strike zone. And he has good bat speed. Because, as we said, he strikes out a lot. So he's more, I think, conscious of just having good bat speed, getting the bat head out, and he did, and then you see a home run.
Quiñones flies to Tartable. Two gone here in the seventh inning, and it'll bring Marty Barrett, who's 2-for-3 to the plate. Tony Armas. And behind him, Kevin Romine, the young outfielder called up, who got a couple of starts last week. Steve Lyons was sent to Chicago. Armas becoming the everyday center fielder, and Romine now in a reserve role up here instead of in the minors. 1-0 the count on Barrett.
And has to do, which is the toughest thing for a young pitcher, which is retain his composure. He is not out of the game. Obviously disappointed, trailing 4-1. This is Fenway Park. You've been around the league a few times. You know that 4-1 is not where you want to be, but very much in a situation. You look at yesterday's ball game where 9 runs were scored by Seattle, where they can come back and get back into this game. A couple of base runners and a fly ball, and it's tied.
Barrett is on again. So Marty reaches for the third time today. And Wade Boggs comes to the plate. With great infrequency this year and has not popped out to an infielder. Bradley can't find it, and even though it rolls only a couple of feet away, Barrett's able to capitalize by advancing to second.
Scott Bradley having a tough day behind the plate, and again, what we talked about, Langston throws 4 different pitches, different planes. Really no excuse, but it does make your job a little bit more difficult.
Scored a passed ball as Boggs takes up and in. Boggs today 0-for-2 and a sacrifice. And now 0-for-12 lifetime against Langston.
Well, last year only hit 2 pop-up spare the entire season. That just seems like it's amazing. One thing that he does so well is follow the ball all the way, which makes him, you see the ball almost hit him.
And so Boggs draws the walk, and Wade gets aboard for the first time today.
Well, an on-base percentage of almost around 47% of the time, and that's one of the reasons he will take a walk if you present it to him. You give him a pitch to hit, he'll hit it.
Coming in today with a .479 on base percentage with Stapleton at the plate. Who hits it in the air to left center field and deep, and backing up to the base of the scoreboard is Bradley, who has room to make the catch. So they settle for Armas's homer and lead 4-1, end of 7. Well, Tom Seaver is finished for the day. John McNamara gets 7 innings from Seaver. Near brilliant. 1 run, 4 hits. the run set up on Armas's error. So Seaver did all you could ask and then some, and leaves with a 4-1 lead as Kevin Romine takes over for Armas in center field. And now Joe Sambito, making a remarkable comeback from surgery, takes over. Mets win 5-3, and there are the particulars. Fernandez wins his 11th. McDowell, who lost for the first time last night, gets his 8th save. Phillies win. Tecovy out of the pen to get the victory. Renicki hits a home run, his 4th, and Jeff Stone is 3rd for the Phillies. Baltimore with Ken Dixon and Don Ossie combining for the shutout. Ossie's 22nd save. Neil Heaton, who just came over in the deal with Cleveland, the loser, and the only run in the game on a homer by Fred Lynn. Here is Harold Reynolds as we go to the 8th inning. Reynolds, Moses, and Bradley facing Joe Sambito.
As you said, an amazing recovery. Torn ligaments in his left elbow when he's with the Houston Astros. They take this bone graft and take a ligament out of your right leg, graft it to your left elbow, similar to what Tommy John, as we see the New England version of the wave.
Comebacker. And Sambito throws him out, one away. Sambito trying to make it back with Houston, then the Mets, but appears to have, I don't want to say come all the way back, but with a 1-0 mark and a 2.74 ERA and only 7 earned runs allowed in 23 innings of work, a valuable man for McNamara if he spots him correctly, and that's exactly what John's done.
He has, and I think it goes with the basic philosophy they have here in Boston this year. Roger Clemens coming off injuries. Royal Can Boyd last year, maybe a little bit tired late in the year. They acquired Sammy Stewart. Bob Stanley, their short man, is healthy. They needed a left-hander to go in the bullpen. And McNamara has used him early in the year, never pitching a full inning. Left-handed hitter here and there. As we said, an extremely hard thrower when he first came up with the Houston. Doesn't throw as hard, but ball sinks down in the strike zone. Has a good slider to go with it as we look at John McNamara. And part of a manager's job is to know when to bring in your pitchers, and he has a gifted bullpen, and that's the big strength. Seaver did exactly what they wanted the younger pitchers to do, the Mike Browns, the Bob Woodwards, the Jeff Sellers. Go 7 innings and let's go to the bullpen, see what they can do.
Moses takes low, and it's 1-2. 1-2, there's one out and the base is empty. Boston leading 4-1 in the 8th inning.
Position of a Tom Seaver will allow them to maybe dally a little bit longer with a Bruce Hurst, who's out with a pulled groin muscle and has been disabled for almost 5 weeks now.
Red Sox expect Hurst to be back after the All-Star break. Seaver allowing 1 unearned run, walking 1, striking out 5 in 7 innings. Two and two the count.
A lot of the experience the younger pitchers on the Red Sox pitching staff received this year will help most likely in September. You go to 40 men if you do that.
To right field, and Evans gauges it. Two gone. Seaver ended his stint by retiring 8 in a row, and Sambito has retired the first 2, so the last 10 Mariners have gone down in order. Seaver limiting the team to 4 hits, all singles.
When you're sitting at home, you say, why would a manager take out a Tom Seaver? As you said, 8 in a row, only 4 hits. I think the real reason is the gentleman on the mound, Joe Sambito, and also the fact that if you limit a guy that's pitched well over 4,500 innings like Tom Seaver to 7 innings, limited amount of pitches, he no doubt will be better the next time out.
Bradley lifts a fly ball to shallow right. Evans has to come charging in and can't make the catch. And Bradley is safe at first base as the throw gets by Sullivan and nobody is backing up. And Bradley around second, on his way to third. Sambito comes up to the ball and his throw is too late. Sullivan had tried to sneak in behind the run.
does that. As you see the almost catch, Barrett heads up second base, goes out and gets the ball. As you see Bradley pop it up into short right field. Evans ball all the way. Right here is where Sullivan is kind of slipped behind Bradley. You see the errant throw. Zambito is somewhere between second and third. Retrieves the ball and makes the late throw to third.
So a base hit and then a two base throwing error on Barrett as Presley comes to the plate. Seattle's first hit since the fifth inning. Four runs on only four hits and two errors for Boston. One run, five hits and two errors for Seattle. Presley hitting .283, 17 home runs and 59 runs batted in. To deep left field, and all of a sudden it is 4-3. And as the late Bob Prince, the gunner, used to say, a bloop and a blast.
You saw it right here at Fenway Park, and what we talked about last inning. Mark Langston, lose your composure, put your team out of the game. He really, you never do that here. 17 home runs. This is the 18th one. Fastball with too much of the plate. As we said, Zambito is not the hard thrower he used to be. Has to stay on the corners, out of the middle of the plate, especially the home run hitters. Speaking of home run hitters, here's another one.
Phelps is in 13 this year and takes low, so it's 4-3. The home run for Presley is his 18th of the season, and Bob Stanley is in the bullpen. Strike. Good battle for the home run lead in the American League. Jesse Barfield has 21. And then you've got Jose Canseco and Wally Joyner, the two rookies, along with Ken Herbeck at 19. Gary Gaetti, Lance Parrish, Mike Pagliarulo, and now Presley, all with 18 home runs. Half swing strike. 1-2. Making it 4-3. Two out, bases empty in the eighth.
Well, the one thing that Dick Williams commented that this team will not quit. We're playing the way he wanted them to play when he came over. He said one thing they are not is quitters. And very easy for a team that was, as we said earlier, expected to compete for the division crown. American League West, a horrendous start.
3-2. Phelps and Tartable is the batter. McNamara goes to the mound and McNamara goes to the bullpen as well. So it's 4-3 and Bob Stanley making his way in. We'll be back.
This is Corey McFerrin in New York. In San Francisco, Giants and Cardinals. The big story here is Steve Carlton's new Giants uniform first appearance. This is released by the Phillies. Hammered pretty good here. St. Louis scoring one run. The run will be out at the plate. St. Louis leads at 1-0 in the third inning of play.
Meanwhile, the big story, as you look at Stanley loosen up, is Bob Horner has hit another home run, and that's four today for Horner in Atlanta, and he becomes the first man to do it in 10 years. As Tarnable fouls it away, and that ties, of course, a major league record. Mike Schmidt was the last to do it in 1976 when he hit four at Wrigley Field. And Bob Horner today against Montreal has hit four at Atlanta Stadium to join others like Willie Mays, Joe Adcock, Gil Hodges, and Rocky Colavito was the last to do it in the American League back in 1959 as Tartable fouls it away. And they lost the game 11-8. Montreal beats Atlanta as Horner hits four home runs in a losing cause.
That's a lot of dingers.
What?
A couple of years for some players. Crawford pitched yesterday along with Bob Stanley. Stanley was injured last year. Growth on his pitching finger. But is supposedly healthy. He's lived and died, but really by the ground ball, as he said the other night when he tried to save Roger Clemens from a defeat, wasn't able to do that. Sinker, slider, and a palm ball.
2-2 is follow. Talking about living and dying, that's what Tom Seaver has to be basically doing right now in the clubhouse. It's going to be an agonizing feeling. You leave after pitching like that, you have the lead, and you assume there's a radio or a television on in the clubhouse, and that's how you learn of your fate. John McNamara earlier talked about what he expected when the Red Sox left spring training.
Al, I thought that we had a very good chance. Our only question was our bullpen, because that was a shortcoming last year. And felt with a healthy Bob Stanley and Steve Crawford, the addition of Joe Sambito, I felt that our starting pitching was fine, was solid. And as you know, I am pitching orientated, and I felt if we could shore up our bullpen, we would have a very good chance.
John McNamara talking about his Red Sox. Most experts figure they would finish fifth or sixth as Jim Rice starts the bottom of the eighth inning. Go back to spring training. Toronto, the defending champion, a young, up-and-coming, bright team. A lot of people thought Detroit would rebound. The Yankees and Baltimore were also certainly more strongly considered by most than Boston. And even Milwaukee picked ahead of Boston by a number of writers, broadcasters, and those who follow the game pretty closely.
Did not even mention Sammy Stewart, who has been on the disabled list, soon to come off. 3-1 on the year, but only limited to 26 innings. When you talk to a lot of the Red Sox writers, they talk about the fact that they need him because a lot of their young pitchers haven't been getting into the 56 innings.
Rice hits it to right center, and making the play is Moses for the out. Well, tailing away, but Moses with good speed, tracking it down, one away. Don Baylor hitless in three trips today. Comes up batting 259 with 15 homers and 55 RBIs. The Mariners have their 6, 7, and 8 hitters, Scott Bradley, Dave Henderson, and Spike Owen due up in the ninth inning.
Pretty big strike zone today. Again, if you hit the catcher's glove, which Langston's done a lot of times, as you see him again going up and in, and that's the book on Donnie Baylor. Likes to get his arms extended. If I look at Don Baylor, I look, the key to his swing is his left shoulder. When he does not hit well, he pulls out. He didn't there. Got a hanging breaking ball up in the strike zone and just hammered it to left.
So one on and one out, and it will bring up
Evans. Once again, you can see a 2-1 slider. Baylor right on it.
This telecast presented by Authority of Major League Baseball may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form without the express written consent of Major League Baseball. Evans has struck out twice and hit into a double play. Top of the fourth inning, the Cardinals now lead the Giants 3-0. And so Steve Carlton struggling in his San Francisco debut.
One underlying thing when you talk about Steve Carlton is that even the games that he does pitch well, he doesn't get much support. He pitches poorly, he doesn't get support. He pitches well, he doesn't. We see another strikeout by Mark Langston.
91 miles per hour that last pitch, and it's 7 strikeouts. And on the subject of Carlton, the word just comes through to us that Mark Davis has taken over in the fourth inning. So Carlton's debut as a Giant, he lasts only 3 1/3. He gives up 3 runs, and the Cardinals also have a couple of men on with 1 out in the fourth. Romine at the plate in the count 0-1. Romine called up from Pawtucket. Has some speed. And was hitting better than 300. 304 was his average in AAA.
Langston has done exactly what we talked about a couple innings ago. The game looked like it was out of hand. Stayed in there. His team has come back to trail by a run here in the bottom of the eighth. So if you're a Seattle fan, the scenario is he needs an out, then you go sit on the bench and hope for your team to score a couple of runs, which will not be an easy task against Bob Stanley. The only way you get to that position, of course, is to get 3 outs here in the bottom of the eighth. Two and two. Again, talking to Phil Reagan, the pitching coach, he talks about the emotional makeup of Mark Langston. High strung.
The difference in the game is that home run by Tony Armas in the seventh inning, which looked like frosting, but as Jim pointed out at the time, 4-1 in Fenway Park. Ain't like 4-1 in a few other places.
Been in games here where you go into the ninth inning 7-1, 8-1, and you don't have enough runs. At least you get that feeling on the bench.
3-2 now with 2 out. So Baylor will be taking off from first base.
Put yourself in a position by going 3-2. You know that Baylor will be running, most likely would score on a double. We see ball 4.
Runners at first and second now with 2 down.
There's a just little subtleties, Al, that the difference between a full count and a 2-2 count means sometimes a run scoring and a run not scoring.
Sullivan coming up and Regan now going to the mound. Again, if you joined us late, Dick Williams was ejected from the game in the first inning. Ozzie Virgil has taken over, and Regan, the pitching coach. And Langston will stay in to face the Red Sox catcher. Again in the ninth inning, Scott Bradley, Dave Henderson, and Spike Owen due up for Seattle. Sullivan started the day at 207, so 0 for 3, and he's down under the 200 mark. High fly ball and down the line and into the corner, and corner. It is a... What is it? Out of our view, and Phil Bradley, whatever happened, is pleading his case with the third base umpire. Larry McCoy, perhaps contending fan interference?
No doubt about that, Al. What he's saying is somebody reached into the playing area and interfered with the out. Which they have the right to do, but the umpire's job is if they do that, in his estimation, the ball should have been caught or could have been caught to call him out. And this is what the argument's about.
And now this will precipitate another umpire's conference. Third base umpire is Larry McCoy. The plate umpire is Vic Voltaggio. That's Ozzie Virgil out there. Virgil, the acting manager.
I'm sure Ozzie's saying get some help, similar to what happened in the first inning. Change the call then.
And I believe what he's being told is that the fan did not reach out into what would be the playing surface to interfere, though Bradley will contest that. There is the area in question. And as you can see, you've got about 2 feet of foul territory. And if somebody reaches out, they're almost in contact with the fair ball, is what it amounts to.
Larry McCoy would have the best view as the third base umpire positioned on the foul line would be running right down the foul line, getting out there as close as he can, and should be able to see if it indeed occurred. Anybody reaching onto the playing surface or the playing field.
So Sullivan stays alive. The count is 0-1, and the next pitch is taken low, and the count is 1-1.
Mark Langston shakes his head. He says, first I throw a fly ball that should have been an out, then I throw a curveball that should have been a strike. Call it a ball. The count goes to 2-1.
Sox leading 4-3, two on, two out of the eighth inning. Inside. Three and one to count. Boston, and suffice it to say, the Mariners are not particularly enamored of the arbiters today.
No, they're not. Hitters count 3-1. Langston knew he had to throw a strike, so did Sullivan. Screeno, we used to call it up here in Fenway. Fly ball into the net.
His first homer of the season, and we mentioned earlier that his first career homer came off Mark Langston. As Quiñones takes outside for a ball, 1-0. Grounded to third, and Presley throws him out. But the Red Sox get a break as the inning stays alive after the questionable call, and they cash in for three and lead 7-3.
Baseball's hottest, brightest, sharpest, and steadiest stars in the All-Star Game, July 15th on ABC Sports.
Ninth inning, Fenway Park in Boston. The Red Sox on top 7-3. Trying to make it 2 out of 3. Tomorrow, Roger Clemens seeks his 15th victory against the Oakland A's. We'll be with you at 8 Eastern time, or the Yankees against Texas. And check the local listings for the game in your area. Mañana. Scott Bradley. Stanley, 0 for 3 to lead off. Bob Stanley now with a four-run cushion.
Look at my coat.
0-1.
We talked about the pitches that Bob Stanley has. The one pitch that, in my estimation, has made him even more effective is the palm ball. Totally paralyzed hitters. Always sinker, slider, two pitches that have the same, basically the same velocity. One a little bit slower than the other, but the palm ball is just giving the hitter another thing to look for.
Jordan Romine in center field. One away. Red Sox are trying to make it 2 out of 3 in this series. And trying to win their 7th in 8 games with Seattle this year. Seattle's only victory against Boston yesterday, 9-5. Dave Henderson, 1-0 the count.
Watched Dave Henderson play yesterday, and the interesting thing is you see the open stance. Most batters that hit with that stance come into home plate. He had it kind of steps straight to the batter, or excuse to the pitcher. And when he does that, he has difficulty covering the outside part of the plate. If you can make pitches away, you're going to be effective against Dave Henderson.
Two and one the count.
Seattle team that is without their first baseman, regular first baseman, Alvin Davis, rookie of the year 2 years ago, out with an ankle injury. Expects to come off the disabled list right after the All-Star game.
Lifted to shallow center, but Romine has to field it on a hop. It's a base hit for Henderson. His first hit of the day. And Owen coming to the plate. Red Sox got a run in the first. Jim Rice drove in Barrett with a base hit. Seattle tied the game on Moses' sack fly in the 5th inning. Then in the 6th, a couple for Boston. Rice drew a bases loaded walk. Baylor drove in the other with a ground ball as Langston's control got him in trouble. He started the inning with a walk. Armas in a leadoff home run to make it 4-1 in the 7th inning. Presley's 2-run homer in the 8th made it 4-3, and then Sullivan hitting the 3-run homer in the bottom of the inning. Following Bradley's contention that a fan had interfered with a playable fly ball that would have ended the inning.
Well, that's Fenway Park. Make a couple of mistakes. An ill-advised throw to third. Get a bad call. Give up 7 runs.
Funny, isn't it, how a guy like Mark Sullivan, hitting around 200, sparingly used, has hit 3 lifetime homers, and there he is, 2 of them off a pretty good pitcher in Langston, the same pitcher against whom Wade Boggs is 0 for 12 lifetime. Two and one. It's crazy. Sometimes the least expected kind of hitter, the guy you would not at all expect to tee off against outstanding pitchers, or the peskiest gnats of all. 2-2. You know who used to really destroy Seaver was Woody Woodward. Now in the Yankee front office, light hitting shortstop, but he owns Seaver.
Going, looking at that pitch and saying that's a ball, yet Attacchio called it a strike.
Slowly hit to second. Barrett settles for the out as he shot puts the ball over to first base, and it almost didn't get there. The Parry O'Brien special. 2 down as Henderson moves to second, and the Mariners are down to their last out.
Every time I see Marty Barrett play, he reminds me more and more of a former second baseman for the Orioles that I played with, Richie Dower, and this would be something that Richie would do. Again, very steady as an infielder, talking about Marty Barrett and Richie Dower. One of those throws, if you had looked at the films, you said, maybe I should have put a little more on it.
Ricky Nelson, just called up from the minors, recalled from Calgary, will bat for Reynolds here. And his pinch hit the other night turned out to be the game winner against Kansas City. So Nelson, just up from the minors, batting with two out of the ninth inning. And time is called as they track down a ball that winds up on the field. Somebody throwing it out of the stands, I presume. Pitch to Nelson is grounded sharply through the middle, but it's Quiñones getting back of second, and he throws him out to end it as the grass floated down, and Nelson grounds out to end the game. And so the Boston Red Sox, with Seaver winning for the second time as a Red Sox, and 308 in his career, they win it 7-3. ABC Sunday Afternoon Baseball has been brought to you by Coors and Coors Light, beers with a difference worth tasting. By Chevrolet, who invites you to drive today's Chevy, live today's Chevy. By Twix, chocolate caramel satisfaction. Light, crispy cookie gets you back in the action. Keep on moving with Twix. And by AC Delco, the smart parts. Final score again, Boston 7, Seattle 3, as Tom Seaver wins the 308th game of his career. Coming up over most of these ABC stations, ABC's World News Sunday with Sam Donaldson, and your local news, except on the West Coast, where they'll be seen at their regular times. Travel arrangements made through a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies more people to Hawaii than any other airline. Nobody knows Hawaii like United. And this has been a presentation of ABC Sports, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television. Well, they cover the field at Fenway in anticipation of some sprinkles, but good weather and a good crowd at 27,000 goes home happy as Boston beats Seattle 7-3. Tom Seaver allows one run, four hits in seven innings of work. And elsewhere, the Mets win 5-3 over Houston. Bob Horner, the big story today, four home runs, but Montreal beats Atlanta 11-8. Philadelphia defeats Cincinnati 12-5. And San Diego was a winner as the Padres beat Chicago. Steve Carlton gets knocked out in the fourth inning in his Giants debut. Cardinals lead 3-0 in the fifth. And the Pirates and the Dodgers are tied 3-3 in the sixth inning at Los Angeles. The White Sox beat the Yankees, and so Boston's lead over New York is now 8 in the AL East. Baltimore behind Dixon and Ossie, and Lynn's home run beats Minnesota 1-0. California leads Toronto by a score of 8-1 in the ninth inning. And Detroit leads Texas 5-2 in the ninth inning. If that holds up, California would be half a game back. Cleveland makes it 7 straight wins, and Kansas City has now lost 9 in a row, 5-0 Indians. And Oakland knocks off Milwaukee by a score of 6-3. Right now, let's check in with Corey McFerrin in New York.
All right, Al, some highlights from around the major leagues this afternoon. First of all, the Yankees and White Sox, Comiskey Park, Chicago, top of one, a man on for Dave Winfield, and he really cranks this thing out. Winfield's 13th home run of the year. Deep in the upper deck, the Yankees lead 2-0. Yankees trying to crank it up and get after the Red Sox, but it would not happen today. So Winfield's home run does not stand up for long. The White Sox in the following inning score 3 times to take the lead over the Yankees. Here is John Cangelosi. Little flare left field. This thing is going to drop in for the base hit. Julio Cruz comes in to score easily. And Chicago goes ahead 3-2. They go on to win 5-2, taking 2 of 3 on the weekend series. Now, the Angels and the Jays at Exhibition Stadium. Top of the second inning. Scoreless game. This is Rob Wilfong. Base hit. up the middle on the bouncer. Jack Howell around to score. The Angels lead it 1-0. California trying to put the heat on division-leading Texas. Top of five, man on Gary Pettis. A shot, left field. This is going over George Bell's head. Rupert Jones scores. The Angels lead 2-0. Next batter, rookie sensation Wally Joyner. A shot down the line, left field. This thing's going to score Pettis, and the Angels take a 3-0 lead. Right now it's 8-1 California in the ninth inning. Kirk McCaskill going after his ninth win on the year. That's the story from here. Now back to Al.
Okay, Corey, and so the Red Sox keep rolling. Take 2 out of 3 over the weekend from Seattle, and their lead in the American League East is now 8 over the Yankees as they get set to meet the Oakland A's behind Roger Clemens tomorrow night. Boston wins it 7-3. Al Michaels, Jim Palmer, so long from Fenway.
Hey, everybody, it's Justin Shackle welcoming you into episode 7 of Towing the Slab, Pitching with David Cone. David's here. James Smythe is here. The Cy Young Awards are here. It's Cy Young Week, David. You're pretty familiar with that, so we have that on our episode here today, but also we're talking to someone very, very special.
Yeah, I mean, Joe Torre is a Hall of Fame person, much less a Hall of Fame manager. I mean, he had a great playing career, over 2,300 career hits. I think James Smythe can put that into perspective for us a little better, but maybe the best combination of a really great player and a really great manager and a really great broadcaster too. He had an excellent broadcasting career, and then he's finishing up his career on the Major League Baseball side of things. He dealt with the umpires, special assistant to the commissioner. So it's hard for me to think about one guy that encompasses so many different skill sets in the history of baseball. In my mind, I think Joe Torre's at or near the top of that list.
Yeah, and he has a way with words. I always thought about that. It always stood out to me, especially when he was the manager of the Yankees, talking with the media all the time, and really got a sense of like the day-to-day grind that a manager has to go through, at least in the town of New York, that market where you do your pregame, your postgame, but it's with a gaggle of reporters every single time. That's really what stood out to me about his way with words. So when you hear stories from him, they hit different a little. And it was awesome to have him on. He touched on a ton of topics. And James, we go through the longevity of what David was talking about: player, manager, union rep, or players union rep, working in the front and as a broadcaster, and at one point potentially interviewing for GM jobs, right? Front office positions, then working into the league's office. So he's really has seen it all. But as a baseball lifer, what stands out to you about Joe Torre?
Well, Coney touched on it briefly. I think he's someone who is, obviously, we know, Hall of Fame manager inducted into 2014. He is fifth on the all-time list in wins. He's fourth all time with 4 World Series championships, only behind Joe McCarthy and Casey Stengel with 7. Connie Mack had 5. Walter Alston also had 4. Decorated manager. We all know that up and down. He had a really underrated playing career. He was a Gold Glove catcher. And then after moving off the position to third base, he wins the 1971 NL MVP in his first season after the position change. And like Coney said, he's over 2,300 hits, over 250 home runs. And to get into a newer metric, baseball reference WAR, he's at 57, which is right around the Hall of Fame borderline. So you have someone who is a borderline playing career at a Hall of Fame level, and then a Hall of Fame managerial career that really pushes him over the top.
Yeah, did it all. 1971 MVP, Gold Glove winner, All-Star. And we talk about Gold Gloves. It was a guy that really did.